Okay. Hi, you doing everybody? Welcome to my channel. This is You Too Can Be Great. I just stuttered. Welcome to my channel. This is You Too Can Be Great. This is the Love and Hip Hop Season 12, Episode 3. It's Reading Rainbow Review. Before I get started, I was going to do the Basketball Wives review. However, the episode yesterday was trash. So I'm just not going to even waste the time. It was just a mess of nonsense and just irrelevant scenes until the very end. I do know that the commercial for what they show for next week is going to be a hit. So I'm going to review that one. I still haven't gotten caught up on Love and Marriage Huntsville. And I still haven't gotten caught up on Real Housewives of Dubai. Because I've already fallen so far behind. It's hard for me to catch up on stuff. So I'm just going to do the best I can. But so far, let's get it in. Because I caught this season in the very beginning. All right. So for those of you who haven't got my notification, go ahead and make sure that you're already pushing the button so you can get what you get. Now, we start off with Sierra in the studio with Khaotic rapping. And I'm like, pause. I understand that Sierra is in Love and Hip Hop, and I understand that hip hop is part of the whole show's pitch. But Sierra being a rapper, she didn't went from being a hairstylist to a nail shop tech owner, whatever the case is, to now going on to making a cooking thing, to now coming up here talking about she's a rapper. There are some professions that require a certain level of natural skill. And nowadays, everybody thinks they can rap. Everybody thinks they can sing with auto-tune. What she was doing, is that the reason for all the, you know, the face job, the booty shop, the body shop? I don't understand what she's trying to do. I don't understand why she's trying to do it that way, because she didn't come on the show as a rapper. She came on the show as a person dating an irrelevant rapper that we don't see no more. Shooter. They shot his ass right off the show. So we don't care. What she should have stuck with is what she knew. Maybe she's doing this. Why? Did somebody try to end her contract or something? Because she doesn't get along with everybody else. Then they just figured, hey, if she starts rapping, we'll keep her on. I'm so confused. Let me know what you think about that situation. But we're in the studio with her and Khaotic. And Khaotic's messy ass decides to invite Erica Banks to come there, knowing that Erica is not really too fond of Sierra because of Sierra's friendship with her arch enemy Rennie, who poured, I think, a drink in her face or something. And Erica comes in and she lets us know that she has a new man, while Khaotic is letting us know that he's trying to shoot a shot again now that she didn't add a few shots into her booty. And I'm just like, what is this? But they're playing the song for Erica, and Erica's sitting there talking about, I prefer the second one, because the first one that I saw, it sounded like she was loud, like she was screaming at the damn, you know, recording, like she was just screaming. And part of it may have been a little hate because of her disdain for Sierra's friendship with Rennie. The thing about it is, this is so childish. I don't know why she has to take out her pain and what she feels about Rennie on Sierra. Your dislike for Rennie doesn't mean that Sierra has to also equally dislike her. Erica Banks seems a little bit immature, in my opinion, and how she handles herself in this situation. Let me know your opinion of what you think. But I don't believe that if I have beef with somebody, that it automatically means that I have to discount whoever is associated with that person. You're not trying to shun them or boot them off the island. That is a bullying tact. I can't be friends with you because you're friends with my enemy. No, how about I can be friends with you, but let's not discuss or have any conversations about the person I don't like, so we can keep your mutual respect and still be able to build a relationship with each other. That would have been better. But Khaotic is in there, and Khaotic is very intelligent, even though he says some dumb shit. He's very intelligent, because instead of him telling Sierra that her songs and her rap skills are not on par with, you know, what rappers would do, like Erica Banks is a good rapper, instead she has Erica do it. And let her know, hey, you know, this may not be it. Like, you need to kind of, you know, you may have the money for the studio, girl, but the voice and the rap skills ain't going for it. Have somebody ghostwrite for you. Then Sierra's out of the studio, and Sierra's talking about the Mama D event and how she basically is in a position to where she's basically not effing with nobody because people didn't come for her or come check on her when she almost had a near-death situation where her leg almost being amputated for a tattoo she chose to have all done in one day. What did you expect? That was a big tattoo, and most people spread it out. You had it done in one day and expected your leg to survive. Your leg was telling you, I didn't have enough. You didn't put too much on me. I'm tired. Then we have her kind of taking a dig at Amy because of her now, I guess, issue with Amy not showing up for her. She now says that Amy, who's also known to have come in the situation rapping, is, you know, she only had 4,000 views on her songs and some nonsense that she was saying. So it's just, hold on a second, my husband's calling. So it's just, I'm sitting here listening to this scene, and I'm just like, this whole thing that Sierra's doing is low-key relevant for me. Then we move on to the horseback riding scene, which I thought was quite boring. But we move on here, and we have Jock and Kendra's behind. Kendra is very beautiful. Her booty alone attracted me before her face. Then you got Rasheeda and Kirk on here, and then the third row, Amy, coming along. Rasheeda now said that she signed Amy to be her brand ambassador for press because Amy's body wore her clothes very well, and I approve. Amy's body wears a lot of things very well. I approve. That was a great business choice. But Amy decides in this scene to bring up her beef that she keeps telling, and I keep looking at the screen talking about, you're making yourself look more dumb, sis, because you're now telling more people about this irrelevant situation because you're now trying to make it an issue. That Bambi is dating somebody that you dated over a decade ago that nobody cares about, that you shouldn't even be thinking about at this point. You should have matured through or from. And you already been engaged. You already been in love. You shouldn't even think about this person considering how far you said you've gone. But here you are bringing him up, and you're now basically trying to make it seem like Bambi did something wrong with you, wrong to you, by not bringing it up to you. At the end of the day, would it have been nice as your friend for her to tell you that, hey, I'm dating somebody that you knew way back then? Yes. But it's like, I'm in my 30s. If somebody wants to come and tell me that they're dating somebody that I was with over 12 years ago, I don't know. I'm probably going to look at him like, okay, cool. The guy told Amy, but I almost feel like Amy and the guy, I keep forgetting his name because he's irrelevant. I feel like, I don't know if he's trying to make Amy jealous by saying I'm with Bambi. And I don't think Bambi's taking him as serious as he thinks. Because he is not attractive to me. Is it just me? His face looks like an acne commercial. Like a face that'd be good for an acne commercial. Like for me, why are you fighting over this person? I don't understand. Is it his pockets? I don't know what it is these two beautiful women are over here arguing about. But he's not it to me. He's not it. All right. Then we have Rasheeda deciding that she's going to end up bringing Amy and Bambi together. And then Amy also mentions that Scrappy, I guess Mama D tried to hook Scrappy and Amy up at some point, and she said no because, you know, she's from with Bambi. And she's making a correlation between her saying no to Scrappy as a friend of Bambi and Bambi dating this other dude from 12 years ago. And I'm the same tune as Jock. This is not the same thing. First of all, you dated this guy 12 plus years ago, weren't engaged to him, weren't married to him, you already got engaged to somebody else. It's been over a decade. Bambi and Scrappy are 2 seconds ago, and they were actually married. They have kids together. You're comparing what you did. Well, it's not the same thing. Amy, you look a little ditzy. I love you, honey, and your body, but you look a little dumb. Then the next scene, question. Why is Diamond and her wigs on the show? For what? Then we have Carly's scene with her daughter, Jasmine. And Carly lets us know that she also wants another child, and she's thinking about doing IVF with her new man, and, you know, she's thinking about marriage. The only thing I got out of the scene that's even relevant to speak of is that Jasmine told Carly the truth, that Carly overreacted with Bambi when it comes to the birthday trip, and that she did not, you know, she's responsible for her part in not showing up for the birthday event. And Carly still deflects and is still mad at Bambi. That lets you just know that the only reason Carly is ultimately upset at Bambi is because she did not like Bambi DMing her man. Carly is very territorial, and considering all the bad relationships that she's had and how people have mistreated her through those relationships, she is having an issue with, she has a huge issue with any of the women that are attractive contacting her man in any way, shape, or form. It's a violation for her, and it touches her in a different way. All this extra stuff with the birthday thing ain't that deep. It's more so because Bambi went ahead and DM'd her man, and that is what she's really mad about. Not this, because even if Jazz is telling you overreacting, you're gonna still ignore that and talk about you don't trust Bambi. No, nobody wanted to show up for you because you're messy. Period. Your daughter didn't even show up, and she claimed it was her fault, and you're still blaming Bambi. Child bye. Then we have her saying that Kai, her former ex that we saw last season, is stalking her and her new man, and that they had a business deal with a beauty line, and that she's trying to keep the business deal. First of all, if you're talking about marrying somebody, why are you keeping a business deal with an ex that still hasn't been fully processed? An ex that you said is stalking you and your new man. Why do that? Again, Carly is very messy. Very, very messy. She likes to stay in drama, and so she creates it naturally. This is a mess. This is a complete mess. Then we have Jock and Kendra's scene. They're having a thank you to Kendra because Kendra closed 50 million, closed 50 million worth in properties, and her body's bomb there too. And I'm very proud of her. It's good to see Kendra and Jock doing something positive other than arguing with who Jock impregnated. Okay? We're tired of that. This is a good way to see them, and it's a good look for them because it actually shows the love they have for each other outside of the mess that he does that she ends up tolerating. Do I think that Jock needs to leave, Kendra needs to leave Jock and all that? Because I know social media has been very harsh with her from what I've seen, and her choosing to stay in a marriage with Jock. Do I think that is fair? Because they're all talking. I see some of the comments they tell Kendra, you know, you didn't know, you were already accepted him having X amount of kids and da-da-da-da-da. You should just let him do this, this, and the third. No, because anybody can look back on the previous seasons of Love & Hip Hop at how Jock behaved and how he treated even Carly and all these other women and can see that there is a change in him in how he and Kendra operates. He's more afraid to lose her. He's more afraid to hurt her. He's more afraid to confront her because he values her, his marriage with her. He values her as his wife. Men don't get scared of hurting a woman or get scared of facing a woman unless they are in, they really do want to keep that relationship with them. I've experienced it with different people. I've had exes that didn't give a damn if I found out that they cheated, and they would just kind of gaslight me, make me feel some type of way and whatever, make us think that it's my fault or why I did something wrong, or exes that didn't care if I was in their life or not because they weren't as invested. You get what I'm saying? But in a marriage that I am in, there's been some situations to where my husband knows I'm mad and he's afraid to come home. You know, not that I want him to be afraid to come home, but it's more like he's like, oh shit, I pissed off my wife. What am I gonna get into? You know, there is a difference in people's behavior. Not to say that that's just that makes all perfect relationship. Just saying that that is an example. I can see how Jock was in the past with all these, then how he is with Kendra. He genuinely does feel bad, does get embarrassed, especially facing Kendra's parents. So I definitely would vouch in the fact that he wants to be a better person just off of being with her. And even if he messed up, and even if he continues to mess up, Rome wasn't built in a night. She didn't make a commitment with this man. And if she ain't gonna leave him, then we should just let her be happy that way. Even if she yells at him on screen, we know that she still ain't filed for divorce. So let him fight and let them stay together. Same thing with Kirk and Rasheeda. I mean, if y'all made it this far, okay, and y'all want to sit up here and keep trying at it, because 60 years from now, y'all may not care about what's happening now, because y'all be old and wrinkled and realize, hey, we stuck through all this nonsense. And everybody who we messed up has moved on, and all the kids are grown and all that stuff. So I do think that Kendra is good for Jock. Even if I don't think that Jock is the best option for her, I think that she's good for him. And sometimes God blesses these men with the woman that they choose. Kendra is not stupid, and she's a good businesswoman, and I'm very happy for her. Now, we keep going, and we get to Bambi coming in with Amy's ex to support Kendra, and you can just see the tension in the room. You can see the look in Amy's face. Amy just looks so upset, and I'm wondering, why? Was it that good? Was it that good? Were you upset that you left him, or are you just pissed off that he's with your friend? I'm so confused. I don't know if Amy is jealous. It seems almost like a jealous person, but why would you be if you've already been in love? Been engaged. You can't say that you've been in love and been engaged if you have feelings for somebody that from 13 years ago. She's acting like a jealous ex. That's what she's acting like. And his face isn't doing it for me, but beauty's only a light switch away. He must have been handsome when the lights get turned off. He may have been doing, because she said later on the show that if Bambi kisses him, Bambi's kissing everything from front to back. So he was out there just eating it wild and getting in every crevice he could. Maybe that's what's making her mad. Maybe she wants that tongue again. I don't know. But she's acting crazy, and people are looking at her crazy. Even those that she thinks are supporting her are looking at her crazy, because this don't make no sense for you to be mad. Then we get to Khaotic's messy self, letting her know that Sierra said that she only had 200 views on YouTube on one of her songs. And I'm just like, Khaotic, why would you even repeat that when Sierra is supposed to be doing a video with you? Are you trying to be messy? I thought you were Sierra's friend too. Or maybe he was just trying to hurt Amy because Amy didn't choose him last season. Amy chose the other dude. And he was like, y'all black love. And we know they didn't make it. And he said his bag is definitely bigger than him. I think Khaotic is a little bit still bitter that he chose Erica over Amy. And he, you know, it's just Khaotic's a little messy in his own way. Then Rasheeda lets us know she set up a photo shoot for Amy, her brand ambassador for press, and that she's going to have Sierra and Bambi come. She lets Amy know that she's going to have Sierra and Bambi come, but she doesn't let Sierra and Bambi know that Amy's going to be present during that entire ordeal. So we're having one-sided situations going on, and they're supposed to have a meetup later. So let's see how it goes. I'll get to that in the next scene. But for now, we got Kai and Carly meeting up. And Carly wanted so bad just to fixate on their relationship. And he wanted so bad to talk about the business. And you can tell that Carly is trying to throw her relationship in his face to hurt him. But this man has a lot of freaking sass. Because the comebacks that he was throwing in Carly's face, I don't think she was smart enough to keep up. He said, now I know why Spice and Shekinah told me not to deal with you, not to F with you. And he was just throwing it. He was like basically telling her, you missed this, you missed that. She was like, you're crazy. And I'm thinking, Carly, you seem like you still want that man. Why? I don't know. But he's a little zesty. And he always gets you whenever you go over trying to argue with you. He always gets you good. And Carly, you end up looking dumb. She was like, I'm going to file a restraining order if you don't apologize. I said, but I thought you were set on filing this restraining order because you said he's stalking you. Why'd you want an apology? Because you don't want to restrain him. You want him to be always around you so you can feel like he's jealous about your new situation. Carly loves mess, okay? Because she creates it. So he came back and apologized to her. And it was just, that whole scene was just, Carly's going to be Carly again. That's what that is. Then we get to press with Amy's body and the outfit that she was wearing and the picture that Kirk was taking and Kirk visualizing his next mark. Then we have Rasheeda, talking about how Bambi and Sierra are on their way. They gave Amy the heads up that they're coming. Amy gives a little speech about how this is a professional event, but if they try her, she's going to reciprocate the trying. And I'm thinking to myself, well, why give that speech if you're not going to control yourself then? Obviously, this is not that much of a job to you. It's more like a familiarity thing because at my job, if I'm making a lot of money, I'm not putting my hands on somebody at my job. I will put my hands on you across the street. We can walk there first, off the job campus, across the street, even if the camera's showing. And I can say, okay, now I'm off the clock. I'm out of work. I'm on lunch. Whatever happens here would not affect my money. Then we can go. But you're in the building of press. You're taking pictures as a brand ambassador and you're telling your boss, essentially, that you may not be able to control yourself. Make it make sense. Then we have Rennie coming in, pregnant and beautiful as she is, with Sierra and Bambi. And first of all, Sierra and Bambi decide to iron out their issues. And Sierra starts with her normal spiel. I just feel like, and I'm like, Sierra, because Bambi was like, Sierra, you're always feeling something. That was rude. That was cold. And that was truthful. Sierra is always feeling something. However, Sierra is making this saying, I was in the hospital for 10 days and you didn't even come and see me. And everybody's looking at Sierra as the person who's more dramatic of the group. So they look at her and they didn't think that what she was going through was serious enough for them to reroute their life to go and support her. And it does hurt her feelings. Now, the one thing I caught with this conversation is, or two things I caught. Bambi did apologize to Sierra for not showing up because she didn't take her seriously. That was good. Secondly, Sierra touched on some. I just know my Bambi to be very sweet, very kind, very loving person. This person that she's turning into with her glow up self, I don't know who this person is. Now, I know who this person is. So, usually from when I see when somebody goes through a huge heartbreak or divorce or something like divorce or something like that, or maybe a death in the family, there is a period of mourning where the person fixates on something as a way to find joy again within themselves. That seems like what Bambi is currently doing. Bambi is morphing herself into somebody else, but she's morphing herself to show I'm happier without you when we all know that she is hurting, having to get up every single day and see how her family has broken and how her ex is over here up the other woman's booty. But that same woman's booty that he was up when you were still effing with him, when you knew he was in the house with her. You lose him the way that you got him. And unfortunately, you had 3 kids before the loss actually happened. But now she's trying to glow up. And the glow up you have for your physical self is not the glow up you chose for your man, because that man is not cute at all. He may have a wonderful personality, but like I said, you can always turn off the lights. No candles needed. Either way, we can tell that there is a difference in Bambi's character. There is a difference in how Bambi's carrying herself. She seems more garden. She seems like just cold, like stoic, like you're hurting my feelings, but she's already been broken so much, your heart broken so much. You kind of harden your heart a little bit that when your friend is expressing something to you, you may not be able to have the same empathy. She made a comment saying that she's the way she is because she don't have to deal with Scrappy's emotional self at home. So she's feeling better, and so she's blowing up because this, this, and the third. But the fact that that man's name still comes into your head when you're having a completely different conversation with somebody else shows where you're at mentally. You're still hurting, and there's nothing wrong with that. But at least be real with yourself. Because if your friend is telling you that you used to be so sweet and so kind and so this, and this version of you is not that, you didn't let that man take the best part of you along with the heartbreak he gave you. And that might be something worth exploring when you quest to find yourself and glow up. Then we have now Amy coming in talking about, I didn't heard everything. She can wait to jump in there and say something. But she came out and she now said to Sierra, you know, you don't support anything that I do, and I've supported you in several situations. Why haven't you come to support me? And Sierra gives her spiel, and it's just unnecessary because Amy's not really concerned about her beef with Sierra. She's concerned about her beef with Bambi. So she throws Bambi in there. You started being mean to me when you started hanging around Bambi's fake ass. And Bambi's like, strike, I'm in, ding, ding, ding. You already, like, you know, tagged me into this conversation, so let's go. Now, the reads between these two females were epic. Okay, before Sierra jumped in, the reads were good because you have Bambi telling Amy, Amy's arguing with her first, and Amy says something like, you think you can slide me? And Bambi's like, you can even slide yourself away from this relationship that was over 10 years ago. Now you think you're gonna slide me? Now they're getting up, and Amy on the confessional says, I don't care how big you are, tall you are, the width of your gums. Now y'all know that Bambi has some very, very interesting gums with the way that her face and her lips is set up. She's still cute though, but her teeth makes up half her face. So Amy clocked that in there in the conversation of her trying to say, hey, this is what it is. Then you now add to this where where Amy's now going off on her and talking about how you when you kiss him, you better taste me from back to front, basically saying that his face was buried, her was buried on that man's face, and she was gliding, she was in there sliding, she was riding, she was doing everything she can to make sure he tasted everything from back to front, including her anus. Then we have Bambi talk about, I haven't done anything with him, I haven't kissed him or nothing. And even if she did do that, that was 10 plus years ago. You trying to tell me that man hasn't washed his mouth in over a decade? That would be a treat for somebody to be that dumb. Can you imagine though, if somebody didn't wash, he's so obsessed with Amy, he didn't wash his mouth for 10. No, but the fact that she said that, I don't think that makes sense, because 10 years means he would have already had several other women in his mouth, but then it wouldn't be just you she's tasting. I mean, there are soul ties here. There are several soul ties his tongue has found, because he's not a married man yet. So he's been sliding through several vaginas. Yours is 10 years past, yours is aged. Okay, there've been other people that have taken your place. So I don't think that you should use that as a comeback. It just doesn't make any sense. So then we keep it pushing. We get to Sierra now joining the conversation and talking about her songs. And she now said, I made a song with Spice, which you were begging for. And basically Amy's basically taking both Sierra and Bambi at the same time. Rennie's just sitting there just watching the situation unfold. She's a pregnant woman, so you're not gonna attack me. I'm not gonna argue with you. I'm gonna protect my baby and my peace. Then you got now Bambi now supporting Sierra because they were friends once in the blue moon, and they're just arguing with Amy, who's standing up now ready to slide on both of them. It was just a mess. And then Amy ends with saying, well, shoot, I might have Scrappy do it next. And then you got Bambi calling her a hoe because that's a trigger for her. And it just became a whole nonsense. This beef that Amy is creating in her head is very pathetic because it doesn't make any sense to anybody with some sense. No woman is that pressed about a man they were with over 10 years ago. And you know, I know that the issue with her is, well, Bambi should have told me. No, what the man told you, because that's the one who actually effed you. If Bambi hasn't even done anything with him, he did right by telling you. But why did he tell you? Is it because y'all are still friends? Y'all are still talking? Y'all are still flirting? Is there something there? I'm curious as to why he told her. I think that there's something there between them that just weren't closed properly. And Amy's feeling some type of way now that the man is parading Bambi in front of her face. And Bambi's sitting up here wondering what the issue is when she hasn't even touched him yet. What if she does touch him and he decides that Bambi's better than Amy? It's just there's too many facets to consider, all of which have no bearing. Because of the length of time it's been. Amy doesn't need to be pressed to this extreme. I get the whole loyalty aspect, but somebody already told you in the relationship. Okay, you could have addressed your feelings with Bambi and see how she feels, but 10 plus years, that's a bit much. That's too much. Anyway, check out the information in the description box below. Like, subscribe, leave some comments. Let me know what you think. You guys have a good rest of your day. Bye.